So Stuart asked me to go through what I've learned about thermal analysis so that I can kind of push some of the liability out to you guys and give some of these projects out to you. So basically today we're going to go to NFRC thermal simulations using therm and Windows 6.3. So we're just going to do a brief overview of it. So you should have three packets that I gave you. You'll have one, just our presentation that we're going over today. You'll have an NFRC rating summary. So this goes through the NFRC and gives you a background of everything that I found online and all the different ratings and how that council works. And then the second one is an NFRC training document. So this goes into great detail about how to use therm and window and how to combine those two together to give you a total fenestration your thermal properties. So those are the packets that you're going to use a lot after this. Today we'll kind of go through just a brief overview of everything and how those are used. So essentially why we're starting to get into this is architects are starting to place thermal property limits on curtain wall systems and storefront systems. The manufacturers test and calculate a lot of their standard systems, but every once in a while we have clients who will do custom systems. And when we have custom systems and there's no backing from the manufacturer, that's where we can kind of start helping out our clients a little bit. So essentially what the architects are specifying are U-values, solar heat gain coefficient, and condensation resistance. The U-value and condensation resistance are a couple of the more important values. And you can see below an example of a specification where the architect is telling us our limits. This is from that University of Michigan project with Vitrum. And so you can see there they've got the U-values and the solar heat gain coefficient values that you have to stay within for each of the different curtain wall systems. So they went into great detail on this one. The next factor that I was going into is condensation resistance. This one's a little bit more difficult because there's no hard value to it. Essentially what you're looking at with condensation resistance is at any given relative humidity, will your interior surface temperature get condensation on it? And so, or will it go below your dew point temperature? If it goes below your dew point temperature, that's how you accrue condensation. And so essentially you have to use the programs that you have at your disposal to find out if that's going to happen. And I'll kind of go into that a little bit more later. So we'll start going into the thermal properties in a little bit more detail. The U factor, essentially that's how fast will heat move in and out of your medium. And so essentially what you've got going on is you're heating a space, you're paying money to heat that space. And at all times, you know, energy wants to flow from high energy to low energy. So at all times your building's wanting to heat the outside. And so we want to insulate our windows or our walls to slow that down since we're paying to heat the inside. And that's the basics of U factor. So you want to keep that as low as possible so you're keeping all the heat that you're producing inside your building. So to go into a little bit more detail of how that plays into glazing systems, you have three different portions of a glazing system. You have your center of glass, your edge of glass, and your frame. Your center of glass is typically your strongest point of thermal, in terms of thermal. So you have two panes of glass and you have an airspace in between. And that air barrier is really going to cut off your thermal transmission. And so whether it's air or argon fill, one way or another, it's going to be your strongest point. Then you have your edge of glass. Your edge of glass is where it gets a little bit worse. Essentially, your edge of glass is where you start getting your secondary seal, and you have either aluminum spacer, or sometimes they're doing like the warm edge spacers with a stainless steel to slow down the thermal transmission. But in essence, since you don't have as much of an air gap, and you have, you know, a thermal conductor in that spacer, it's going to let a little bit more energy out. Then you've got your frame, which is going to be your worst chain or worst ring in the chain, and essentially, I mean, it's the exact same thing with the edge of glass. You have a thermal conductor in aluminum or steel or whatever you're using that's going to give heat a path to get out of your building, in or out of your building.
The U factor is a unitless number,
this, it's BTU per feet squared hour degree Fahrenheit. So that's one that's not unitless. The solar heat gain coefficient's unitless, and then condensation resistance, when we plug it into window, we can get a unitless rating for it. But yeah, the U value is the only one that isn't unitless. And it's basically the inverse of an R value. So if you guys are more familiar with R value, this is just the inverse of that. Okay, so the next section, we're just gonna go into a couple of important factors with U value determination. Essentially what's going on here, the common theme is more frame. Like I said before, your frame is your frame and your edge of glass is your worst point. And so the more frame, the worse your frame, your glazing system's gonna perform. So on the left here, you've got a large punch window opening, and you've got a lot of glass there. And then the next one right next to it just basically has the exact same frame, shrinks the glass. So since you have less glass, more frame, you're about 25% worse on your U factor. And the exact same thing's going on over to the right, where you have the exact same size frame, but you added an intermediate rail, so you're adding more frame to your system, and so your U factor is going to go up by about, or get worse by about 25%. So a couple things to keep in mind when you're going through these. And then also getting into the actual frame and edge glass to kind of show how those play, since those are your weaker links. On the left here, you're showing a non-thermal system, so you can see your frame U factor is 1.32, which is pretty high for your U factor. And then on the right, you've got one with a thermal break that we see a lot of now in like a storefront system, and it's making it 36% better, so it drops down to 0.85. And so you can kind of see the importance of a thermal break. And then the one off to the right is showing a warm edge spacer. So same exact concept, you're using stainless steel instead of aluminum for your spacer inside of your secondary seal. And you're getting about 7% increase in U factor by doing that. They actually are starting to come out with another, I've seen the product, but they actually have a spacer that's made out of like a foam. And so it's not very common because it puts a big black line around your window, so architects don't love it. But it is something that gets you a little bit better values. So we might see that down the road.
When you're saying that that 1.32 is high for the frame, what's a typical U value that you'll see roughly?
0.3, 0.4. So 0.4 is what I've seen a lot of, or seen more often right around there. But this University of Michigan project, they specified 0.3, 0.26, right around the 0.3 or so. So you can see that's quite a bit higher.
When you say thermal break, are we talking about the poured one, or does this also do the strut type?
This one here is a strut.
Okay.
But it applies to the poured one too.
So they would, you would expect them to kind of react the same, or?
Similar. Yeah, you'd have similar performance. So that's why, and that's why you'll see like on some of those other systems, like I've seen some of the 6-inch long systems where they'll have two thermal breaks.
Mm-hmm.
So you have, you know, your member. And in series, as that heat goes through, it's going to hit one thermal break, come out of it, hit another thermal break, so you're just chopping down how much heat's actually getting into it. So
a thermal strut and a poured one doesn't have that big of a difference as far as thermal performance though?
I honestly haven't looked into the differences between them, but it should be pretty similar. I mean, the thermal strut has some air barrier in there too, so I'm not exactly sure, you know, which one's better. I'd have to plug it in. The thing with those are all in the manufactured systems. So the only time I've really done any analysis on that was when I was kind of playing with the programs to figure out how they work. And so other than that, I haven't really, you know, done any comparisons between the two because those are already done by the manufacturer. So it's a good, those are good questions to kind of look into as we're digging into it though. So now going into our actual testing protocols, or testings and rating. So there's two U.S. thermal testing protocols. There's AMA, and they're going to use physical testing in the AMA 1503.1, and that's basically just going to measure U factor and condensation resistance, but it's not going to measure the glass's solar heat gain coefficient. I didn't see anything in AMA that really goes into that. And then in NFRC, they're going to use two different ways to test and rate their system. They're going to use physical testing in the NFRC 102, and they're also going to use thermal modeling, and they're going to use that to determine your U factor in NFRC 100 and then the solar heat gain coefficient in the NFRC 200. And so that's kind of where we're going to focus, because that's the only standard protocol that I found for actually using calculation to measure thermal resistance. So if you want something that, you know, if we're going to produce sealed calcs on it and you want something to kind of have behind you to refer to, that's the only thing that I found that was out there. And so digging into the NFRC a little bit more, they're a third-party rating council. They have three main groups. They have the inspection agency, the simulation labs, and the testing labs. The inspection agency is kind of the overseer. They'll help guide a client through the whole process to get their system validated, and then they'll actually validate the test report. So it's kind of a circular process. Then there's simulation labs. They're going to use the programs to calculate the thermal efficiency, like we were talking about. And then there's testing labs, that they'll take a baseline product, a representation of the glazing system that's going to be on the project. They'll take that product and they'll produce the ratings with testing. Essentially how this works is it'll start with the inspection agency, it'll go through the simulation labs, the testing labs, and then it'll come back to the inspection agency, and the inspection agency will take a look at both those reports, make sure they're within a certain variance, and say, you know, these are your factors. So they'll kind of make sure everything lines up. So digging into the actual NFRC simulations a little bit more, a couple of the programs that we use, starting with window 6.3, this is going to be used to calculate your center of glass U factor, and then it also gives you your total fenestration factor for the whole project. So this is kind of where you start. You want to plug in your glazing system and find out how your glass is going to perform.
Quick question about the glass. It's nothing like analyzing IG. We don't have to worry about if it has any type of acid etching or any type of ceramic coating or anything on it, do we?
Yeah, that's a big portion of it,
okay.
Actually. So this is probably one of the harder things, I feel like. Therm is a little bit more, it's easier to use for, you know, to plug in all the different shapes, but window, you have to be spot on with, you know, what glass you're using, what type of glass, where your coating is, if it's on the inside or the outside, you know, which layer it's on, how many different panes, argon fill. There's a lot that goes into, and you can kind of see here, that's showing that, you know, this one, you know, is a IGU with some low-E coating on one edge, and as you go down the line, as you're adding different air spaces and different coatings, it all plays a factor in it. So yeah, that's a good pickup. Next is Therm 6.3. This is, like I was saying, this is going to be used to calculate your edge of glass and your frame thermal properties. Basically, you're going to take all of your cross sections from your curtain wall system. Let's say we're doing a big curtain wall system. We're going to take your most important cross sections, get them all put together, and we're going to plug each and every one of these into this program. And essentially, it's going to calculate your U factor for each one of those systems, and it's going to give you an interior temperature based on your interior and exterior environment. So that's basically all Therm can do for you. It's a 2D heat analysis program. So now to get into that whole process I've been kind of referring to. Step one, probably one of the more important parts, is determining whether to use the NFRC test size or to use area-weighted averaging. So on the left, you can see, on the left in this image too, the NFRC test size is on your left, the project size is on your right. You can see the NFRC test size has up to 40% higher U value, so it's much worse. So you can see there's a big difference between, it's like we're talking about, this one has more frame, this one has more glass. And so you really have to look at your project and say, you know, am I doing, you know, a single punch window opening? Am I doing, you know, a small storefront? Or am I doing a huge curtain wall? If you're doing a huge curtain wall, you'd probably lean over to the NFRC test sizes and doing, utilizing that. The thing to keep in mind when you're making this determination is if you use area-weighted averaging, you don't have that backing of the NFRC. There's nothing in the documentation about, you know, how to use the actual project sizes that I saw. So you're kind of out on your own. So if something doesn't line up or you have a third party review, you have to really be able to explain yourself and your how you went about it. The other side, you have that backing. You're using a standard protocol. So you can refer back to it. You have guidelines for exactly how you go through it. And you also are meeting the NFRC standards where if they do get this tested, you should line up. So. Once you've got that, this is where we get into the iterative process that I was going into. Essentially, you're going to use Window 6.3. You're going to calculate your glazing thermal properties. Once you have that, you're going to take your glazing, your glass, you're going to plug it into therm. You're going to put that glass on every single cross section of your window system, all the important ones. And then you're going to take those therm models, you're going to run them, and you're going to take those back into window. And once you have it in window, you're going to actually build your curtain wall system, similar to what's shown here. So you're going to build that second part into window, all your important parts, and then you're going to run it. And essentially, it'll give you a total fenestration U value. What I've done from this point is I've kind of combined NFRC standards with area-weighted averaging. And I've taken on, for example, the University of Michigan project. I didn't feel that just looking at a snapshot in the center of the curtain wall met the specifications. And so I took a snapshot at the center. I took a snapshot at my jamb, snapshot at, well, you have both jambs, then a snapshot at your head and sill. Took every one of those unique conditions, and then I averaged those based on your overall area of your curtain wall. So whatever your area of jamb on the other side, area head, area sill, and then area of your center of your curtain wall system. Since that's the majority of the curtain wall system, that drove the factor, but it still included everything by doing that. So I kind of combined them so you still have that backing of the NFRC, but you're also taking into account all the different portions of the curtain wall system. So that was my overview of thermal analysis, and essentially when you guys go through that for a project, there's a ton of information in those other two packets that you have to go through. It's basically all this stuff, just in a little bit more detail, and I've given you a step-by-step process on how to actually use the programs. So.
Could we use this, Stuart, there's sometimes where thermal expansion for taller elevations start becoming an issue, with, you know, if you have quarter-inch expansion. Can we justify using a smaller range for thermal expansion in the inside of a building using thermal? Like, will it tell you what the temperature of the inside of the building is?
It will. I think we've kind of done that once. We've kind of looked at that, but it's a tough one because you still do have specifications for your project that say you have to use this temperature swing to calculate your, you know, your thermal expansion. But, you know, essentially you do have a temperature swing from therm that you can use, but like I said, it's kind of a gray area because you have specifications that you're supposed to stick to too.
Yeah. I think that there's the possibility if you get into a tough, tight spot, you know, and you're right on the barrier of being able to make it work out, showing the architect, you know, something like this that shows that the back member of the whole thing, you know, is at a certain temperature, you know, that should be some good evidence, but I don't think that we can solely, you know, rely upon that evidence, you know, to get us by.
How easy is it to, if we wanted to do that, to go through this? I mean, would that be a pretty time-consuming process?
To run one cross-section in therm is a couple hours.
Okay.
So if you want to just look at, you know, one vertical, see what your temperature swing is, You are kind of held to NFRC's standard exterior environment and then their standard interior environment, which is, you know, 75 degrees, and then the exterior, and they have winter and summer conditions. So you can, I mean, you can do it, but I'd say just to get your model set, it's probably a couple hours, and then after that, kind of playing with it, you know, a couple hours here and there.
I have a couple questions. My first question is, so when the architects are specifying these U values, is that for the like combination of all curtain walls? Because, I mean, we've all seen it in projects where one curtain wall can have, you know, this window layup, and on this one it can have a different window layup. So are they talking about the overall building envelope has to have this U value, and that's what we're trying to meet for the windows? Or are we, do they specify it on a curtain wall by curtain wall basis?
It's usually a curtain wall. I mean, what I've seen when I've only had the one project where I actually had to run it,
yeah,
and it was curtain wall by curtain wall, because each glass was completely different. So that's good to key in on that. So I would guess, you know, I haven't looked a ton into just a standard project that I'm not running Thermon, but I would guess if they, you know, have a bunch of different glazing in the architect specs, it's going to call out, you know, this, at least breaking it up by storefront and then curtain wall.
Mm-hmm.
And then within those, you know, the different glazing types, they're going to say. But what they'll do is they'll say, you know, CW2, that needs to meet this U factor. And then CW3 or whatever, that needs to meet this U factor. So it's kind of how they'll do it. They'll
so
do the whole
system. So that kind of leads me into my second question. When you have, let's say CW2 that we're referring to, has, you know, it's a multi-story span, and you have several locations of spandrel glass that typically has a different glass layup or, you know, different coatings on it than any other thing. So when you have a situation where you have, let's say you have a horizontal mullion, above glass, the top glass, you have a different coating on it than the bottom. I mean, is it just a property thing that you're just inputting and getting the two different values of the window on top and bottom and seeing how that affects it?
Yeah, you can do that. So basically you can run in window glass design two different glazing systems. You'll have glazing system A, glazing system B. Then when you come into therm, each one of those, like for instance that horizontal rail that I showed you here, each one of those glazing systems on top and bottom, you input independently.
Okay.
So I had to go in and put glazing system A on the top and glazing system A again on the bottom.
Okay.
So you can do it where you do A and B. And then that's essentially why I didn't feel that if I just did, you know, a snapshot in the center like NFRC says, that it does cover everything. Because if you do have something that has, you know, some coatings and it is a larger area of the overall curtain wall, if you deem that, then it is something that could play into the overall curtain wall's thermal properties. So it's definitely something to, yeah, that's a good question. So it's something to take into account.
Matt, can you speak to NFRC and certification criteria?
How to be certified?
Yeah, and so, you know, project specs a lot of times call out for certification. Go ahead and kind of speak to that.
So with the NFRC, essentially they have those three different rating councils. They have your inspection agency, your simulation labs, and your testing labs. Each one of those has NFRC certified people involved in them. So they'll have NFRC certified inspectors, NFRC certified simulators, and then NFRC certified testers. And so essentially to be a certified simulator, you have to go through a 1-week program that the NFRC puts on, I believe it was once a year. And you go, I think it was in Minnesota, and you go and you sit through and figure out, you know, they teach you how to do full simulations on a curtain wall system or on how to basically use those programs to put all this together.
Yeah. So, you know, in the specifications, it requires, you know, a certain value that they'll set up for U values and condensation resistance factors. A lot of times they require a certificate to be issued, you know, based on NFRC criteria. And so we can't give that certificate. And that's what it boils down to. A lot of these manufactured systems already have been through the program and they've got internal certificates already available, and that's why we don't have to go through a lot of the process on the manufactured systems themselves in getting that certificate or even doing the thermal analysis. It's already pre-done based on a, you know, some mock-up, you know, that they've put into NFRC. So we don't have to go through that process normally. It's the custom systems that we really get into, you know, this issue. And so we've got to be very specific to the architect and the general contractor that we can't provide that certificate, but we can provide the calculations in the simulation as long as they'll accept a sealed set of calculations.
Have we ever looked at getting people up there to get certified?
Not enough business yet.
Not enough business.
At some point we will. Yeah.
When you say custom systems, are they like custom bullions or
yeah.
Or just the ones that haven't been tested by the manufacturer?
Usually custom. Like for instance that University of Michigan project, that wasn't, the verticals were an HSS2. So it was an HSS2 and the glass was structurally sealed to the HSS2. So it's completely custom pieces, you know, screwed and pieced together to create a curtain wall system. So like Stuart says, it's not something that they can come in and say, you know, the Conair 451T system, you know, go back into their documents and pull the NFRC certified simulation and say, hey, this meets all your stuff. Mm-hmm. Now let's get our structural. They don't have that for, you know, an HSS tube system. Or that other project that we're starting to get into where they're gonna piece together stainless steel bars and bronze and all that kind of.
So with the glass layup, if they have some sort of solar band coating that is very different from what they test, that's gonna have a big impact on the U values, right?
Yeah, and you have to stick to, like I was saying with the with window, you have to stick to what's in the program. So you have to find something that meets it, you know, the thickness of the glass matters, where they have the coating, whether it's on, you know, if you have your exterior glass and you have your coating, you know, on this side, it matters, as opposed to if it's on the interior portion of the airspace, and all that matters, what coating it is.
Mm-hmm.
They'll have special coatings for different manufacturers, and those will all have different values, even though they say, you know, this is one low E coating. You know, low E coating from a different manufacturer is different. So you have to kind of do some digging on what your client actually bought, so you know what to plug in there.
But there is a database of all the coatings.
Yeah, there's a part of the programs I didn't really get into because it's a simple program that you have to download. It's in this, but it's the International Glass Database. And so every time you open window, you need to make sure that updates because it'll have all the newer glazing pieces. So.
With the, so if we're thinking about a Conair system that's gone through the NFRC standard test size, system passes, all that, how do you compare that to what's actually on the job? Because like you're saying, if you have more frames, smaller sizes, it's going to be different. So how do you say that, yeah, it's been tested, we're fine, but on the job, it's a completely different...
When it comes to that, it's kind of the... I mean, that's a good question. I haven't really gotten into that. It's partially up to the... I don't know if they go through on every project and go through the inspection agency, but basically how that should work is on every project, they come through this process. They'd go to the inspection agency and say, hey, I'm using this Conair system. You know, these are my drawings for the job. And I need, you know, I need a certified simulation report. I need a full package. And that inspection agency should be able to, you know, look at the project and come through and say, you know, your simulation and your test are representative samples of the project. And they have to do that, you know, that same exact thing I was talking about. Here, they have to decide, you know, if these are a bunch of punch window openings and our NFRC size doesn't, you know, it doesn't make sense here, or, you know, they have to kind of do that. So I'm not exactly sure how, you know, our clients get.
Isn't that what mock-ups are for, though? When they, for larger projects, like for high-rises, they submit mock-ups, right? And they test some of them.
And then they probably actually do go through the process.
Yeah.
But you know, on the smaller projects where it's already done, it's a mock-up that, you know, Conier has put up, you know, with their typical system and their typical glazing. And so if there's ever a question about it and the architect says, you know, no, you know, we've got a different type of a coating or something like that, or you know, a different layup of window, it probably goes back to the manufacturer, you know, through the glazing contractor to the manufacturer and say, help, you know, get us past this point. And then they probably have somebody doing some internal simulations using this, and then they pass it up the line and it's all good. I think that's probably what happens. And it's a lot of times it's, you know, without the certificate, but they have the certificate based on a standard mock-up.
I don't want to make an ass out of you and me, but I'm going to assume that when they do those mock-ups and whatnot, that they probably aren't using any coatings. They're probably trying to use the worst glass that they can. I would assume that's what they are doing, but you know, you don't really know.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
The mock-ups are usually supposed to be representative of what's going to be on the building, so the architect can get a feel for how it looks. So you might have a low-E coating that's got like a gold color to it. They'll want to have that installed so they can see how it looks.
Well, I'm talking about the testing work that they do before the project even gets built. Those certificates that they ran for their models, I'm assuming, and we don't know unless we ask, that they're probably using no coating and everything. They're just using straight glass. That way it's getting, if you will, the worst thermal performance that system could potentially see. And
I would think they would test several different ones, like you're saying, blank glass, low E coatings, double glaze.
What's low E? What does that stand for? Because I see that all the time when it says low E coating.
Low emissivity. So it basically lets less heat in.
It's about radiation of the sun or whatever.
Yeah, so when the sun hits that coating, rather than just letting everything sink right through, because that's what solar heat gain coefficient is, basically it's how much, because you could have a really good, you know, thermally good window, but if you sit next to it when the sun's out, you know, like right next to it, it could still be kind of hot because the sun's beating in on you. So those low heat coatings, if I understand right, it basically has some, you know, some stuff in it that pushes away some of that. So it reflects it back out.
I read it on the Glass Magazine ones that the coating on the building was so reflective they actually burned some cars on the parking lot.
Melted some cars
in the
interior stuff.
Yeah.
You guys have any other questions?
And these, I mean, we all have access to these programs. Are they on the server or?
They're on the server. They have updated versions like Therm and Windows 6.4 or 5 that might be on now. But we have to check periodically, because if we want to stick to those NFRC standards, the only ones that are approved are the 6.3 as of the last time I've done it. So those are the only ones that are allowed in there. So those updates aren't included yet, from what I understand. They're not. They specifically call out you have to use thermal Windows 6.3. So every time you do a glass project, I have it in that manual to check that.